Welcome to ILTV's Israel Daily. I'm Lauren Izzo. Coming up in this edition, well, Biden or Trump? The American election has far-reaching implications. We'll delve into how the Middle East is talking about the vote. Israel's prime minister announces street stores will open next week as restrictions for COVID-19 continue to ease. And get your iPhones ready to shop. Apple Pay will finally drop in Israel by the end of the year. We are 2 days after the U.S. election and still no result. President Donald Trump and former Vice President Joe Biden are neck and neck in one of the most contentious elections to ever take place. But as results pile in, it's looking more and more like Biden is taking the lead. Whoever wins this election will impact the entire world, but the Middle East has a special interest. Let's take a look at how the media in the region's covering the U.S. vote.
إذن مشاهدينا تغطيتنا مستمرة للانتخابات الرئاسية الأمريكية مع احتدام السباق بين ترامب وبايدن وانحسار التنافس في ولايات حاسمة.
مشاهدينا الكرام أهلا بكم ونواصل معكم هذه التغطية الخاصة للسباق الرئاسي في الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية وقد اقتربنا من الأمطار الأخيرة وربما أصبح الرئيس المقبل قاب قوسين أو أدنى كما يقال تأتي النتائج تباعا نتائج مهمة قد تأتينا في الساعات المقبلة أيضا وقد ننتظر حتى الجمعة لا أحد يدري مرشح يتقدم في ولاية ثم أخرى ثم يتقلص الفارق وهكذا
أهلا بكم أعلنت وسائل إعلام أمريكية فوز المرشح الديمقراطي جو بايدن في التصويت بولاية ميشيغان المتأرجحة بعد فرز أكثر من 99% من الأصوات.
قال المرشح الديمقراطي للرئاسة الأمريكية جو بايدن إنه يتوقع الفوز بالانتخابات معبرا عن اعتقاده بأنه من الواضح أن حملته تحقق النصر فيما يكفي من الولايات للفوز بالرئاسة. وأضاف بايدن خلال كلمة وجهها للأمريكيين أنه في حال فوزه بالانتخابات سيكون رئيسا لجميع الأمريكيين.
שלום לכם ובוקר טוב, אנחנו פותחים את העדכון שלנו עם הבחירות בארצות הברית, שם גם יותר מיממה אחרי סגירת הקלפיות עדיין.
Okay, let's bring Kevin Racklin into the conversation. He is the U.S. Director for the Alliance for Middle East Peace, and he joins us now from Arlington, Virginia. Thank you so much for joining us today, Kevin.
Thank you for having me. Happy to be here.
So, first of all, let's start with the situation on the ground where you are. Are people getting restless since we don't have a result yet? Or has everyone accepted that, you know, Joe Biden might be close to victory?
I think restless is the right word right now. I think we're all just kind of having to do something which, you know, we don't normally have to do in presidential elections, which is being patient and just kind of waiting to see what's happening and just waiting for the votes to actually come in. Already right now, we're seeing so many of the races tightening up, be it in Nevada, Arizona, Georgia, or Pennsylvania. But I think, you know, right now on, you know, just on the New York Times, you know, it's 253 to 214 with 71 electoral votes still outstanding. And I think you're going to see some challenges coming in. But the fact that, you know, Wisconsin and Michigan both flipped blue in 2020 does speak volumes of where the electorate is going. And I think that you know, people haven't made a decision. You know, there are some people on the Biden side that are very positive and thinking that this will, you know, this kind of signifies the end of the race with those two being called and how close things are in Arizona and Nevada. But I do know, you know, just based on the president's recent tweets as well as his statements over the last couple of days, that you're going to continuously see challenges in certain areas.
So let's zoom out for a second. You know, we just watched a piece about the intense coverage coming from the Middle Eastern networks about the election. How much would the winner of this election actually affect the situation or the status quo in the region, especially just on the heels of the Abraham Accords?
So I think, you know, you have to take a step back and kind of look at what has happened in the last 4 years in terms of how this administration has affected the region. And I think that, you know, if people are expecting, you know, Vice President Biden to immediately withdraw the embassy from Tel Aviv, from Jerusalem and move it to Tel Aviv, or, you know, recant on the Golan Heights announcements, I don't think that's going to happen. But I think This is a very different individual. You know, Vice President Biden has over 40 years in foreign policy experience, and he has, Israel is very near and dear to his heart. So I think you're going to see him jumping in with both feet and trying to address the situation quickly. But I think, in terms of the status quo, things will be kind of stable, kind of maintain itself for the first 6 months or so, just simply because we're dealing with a pandemic. And I know the vice president has made it very clear that he wants to address that at home before anything else happens.
Do you think that Joe Biden would try to bring the Palestinians back to the negotiating table after they were sort of alienated by the Trump administration?
Absolutely. This is something that his surrogates have said many times, that and one of their critiques of the president was that they did ostracize the Palestinians, be it closing the PLO office here in Washington, D.C., to cutting off development and humanitarian aid to NGOs operating in the West Bank and Gaza, and really just kind of doing a maximum pressure campaign on the Palestinians. And I think the vice president understands the importance of diplomacy. He understands the importance of peace, both to the Israeli population as well as to the Palestinian population. And so he is, you can't just make peace with one party. He's going to re-engage both sides. And I know he's already made a commitment to restart development and humanitarian aid to the West Bank and Gaza to get those critical supplies in as needed. And, and from my point of view, and from, the Alliance for Middle East Peace's point of view, one of the things he should be doing and looking at is really re-engaging civil society on the ground in the West Bank, because so much damage has been done to the relationship between the Palestinian, not just the relationship between the leadership of the Palestinians, but actually the trust on the ground between the Palestinian people and the American population. So he's going to have to make a significant push to really engage that population.
And, what about Trump's peace plan, the deal of the century? Is that something that Biden could potentially continue with, or is he going to start from scratch?
I think, one of the things that, I think one of the few things that the president and the vice president agree on at this point is the idea of a two-state solution. I think that the question is how to get there. Vice President Biden has made it very clear that any peace process has to be with both parties. It can't just be negotiated with one side. And the Trump peace plan, that is exactly what happened. It was essentially a one-sided negotiation. And so coming back into that negotiation process and bringing in Mahmoud Abbas and others in the Palestinian leadership, he's going to have to start over. And I'm not saying start from 2014, because I think that the reality on the ground and with the population between both Israelis and Palestinians has changed tremendously. And that's one of the reasons why I say constantly, you have to re-engage civil society and kind of gain that trust back. One of the things that we're actually talking about and working on here is creating an international fund for Israeli-Palestinian peace to grow civil society and create that constituency for peace, not only in the West Bank and Gaza, but also continually to grow that constituency for peace in Israel itself.
Right, so we'll have to wait and see, but hopefully we'll know, maybe even in the coming hours, who is going to be the winner of this election. Kevin Racklin, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you. Really appreciate it.
Moving on now, Israel is continuing to ease COVID-19 restrictions and plans to open street shops this coming Sunday. The new regulations will apply only to green areas with a low infection rate, and only 4 customers will be allowed inside shops at a time.
אנחנו כינסנו עכשיו את קבינט הקורונה. בדיוק כפי שהבטחנו בישיבה הקודמת, אנחנו נפתח את חנויות הרחוב ביום ראשון הקרוב. אנחנו מאפשרים 4 לקוחות בכל עת, לא יותר מזה. ואנחנו גם יודעים שיש עלייה מסוימת בתחלואה, ולכן אם אנחנו נראה בסוף השבוע הבא, לקראת השלב השלישי הגדול, שיש עלייה בתחלואה, אנחנו נצטרך לעצור, ואולי אפילו להדק את ההגבלות. בשלב זה, זו ההחלטה שלנו, פותחים את החנויות, מאפשרים 4 לקוחות, ואני מבקש מכולם לכבד את הכללים הללו.
Also, all those Israelis who have been planning to take a vacation to Greece may have to change their travel plans. As of November 17th, Greece will no longer be included in the list of countries Israelis can travel to without having to quarantine upon return. Meanwhile, Jerusalem's Hadassah Medical Center says they have ordered 1.5 million doses of a Russian-made COVID vaccine. The delivery is pending a health ministry permit the hospital is in the process of obtaining to be able to administer the medication to COVID patients in Israel. Now let's take a look at the numbers. Israel's health ministry saw 755 new cases since Wednesday, bringing the total active cases to 9,407. The death toll stands at 2,638. Now, as you may or may not have noticed, the international cannabis market has exploded over the past few years, and it's only getting bigger. One Israeli company, Trichome Shell, is now earning the spotlight with an all-new approach to cannabis products. Here to tell us all about them is Trichome Shell's CEO and founder, Guy Shibaz. Hi, Guy. Thank you for joining me today.
Thank you for having me.
So first of all, you brought in some samples of your product to share with us. Why don't you first explain exactly what you brought today?
Sure. So I brought two different samples, two different products. One of them is called Mood Picks. And what it is, it's basically a cannabis concentrate that we brought into a shape and a rigidity of a toothpick. So it looks like that. That's the packaging. And basically, so it looks like a toothpick. But
it really looks like a toothpick.
What it is, actually, you don't supposed to put it in your teeth, but you actually smoke it. It's a smokable product. And the way that the consumer use it is by just sliding it into a cigarette or a pre-roll. You get a consistent dosage of cannabinoids in each unit. So makes the whole ceremony of cannabis consumption way easier.
And what is the actual stick made of?
The actual stick made out of the cannabis concentrate.
Oh, wow.
We're basically taking a flower and reducing it into the shape of a toothpick.
Interesting.
So that's the idea.
All right, and the other product you brought with you today?
So for consumers that want to stay away from smoking, we also have another solution. We call it Power Powder, and it's a water-soluble powder made from, again, the cannabis concentrate. And again, we bring a very different approach for this market. And the idea is that, you know, every consumer can now use this powder in their favorite beverage, so whatever it is. So it just makes cannabis consumption so much easier. You just put it in your drink. If you want to put, you know, if you want to put one to get the 10 milligrams dosage, you can put one. If you want to get higher, you can put two, exactly like you like to sweeten your coffee or tea. Now you can also implement cannabis into your life.
So obviously, you know, these are really creative solutions, how to consume cannabis. How did you come up with these ideas? And, you know, tell us about the beginning of Trichome Shell. Where did this idea come from?
So Trichome Shell is an Israeli-based company. And we basically created Trichome Shell to develop innovative products that will make cannabis way more accessible for the general population. I've been in the cannabis market for a decade now. So I've seen all the trends come and go.
Right. And from way before it was as popular
way
as
before,
it is now.
From 2011, so way before even a single state in the U.S. Legalized cannabis. We saw that there's a very big opportunity that basically lies within the demographic that doesn't want to take part in this industry because they don't know how to approach it. So we wanted to bring a solution for them by making cannabis more accessible for them. And this vision is basically what brought us together and what brought us to develop all those products.
So what is ahead for Trichome Shell?
So Trichome Shell up to now, so we already completed all the development of both of those products. And we already have a few agreements signed with cannabis manufacturers in the U.S. and in Europe. So the proof of concept is behind us. We're looking to expand now.
All right.
Join us and
great.
Grow with us.
I'm sure all our viewers wrote that down. Thank you so much for joining us, Guy Shibaz, and best of luck.
Thank you for having me.
2020 is the year of adaptation, including in education. Since the global pandemic took over our lives, schools and universities have been disproportionately affected by closures, having to provide students with alternative ways to learn and have the post-secondary experience. Take a look.
This year looks different for students at the IDC. Entrances blocked off, parking lots vacant, and a new school year without the fresh breath of life it usually gets. And while the university experience is altered significantly for the time being, a large number of study abroad students in Israel are still choosing to stay rather than return home.
I still have hope that things will change and we will get the opportunity to come back to the campus and have our college life back.
It's a choice of going home to be with family or salvaging whatever sense of normalcy they can. Their administration implementing new policies to enable them to do that.
Even though my parents were stuck in Italy because the situation there was very hard, I felt at home. I felt unity all together, all my friends and the people here at IDC, which helped you all the time with any problem.
I did the right choice by staying here in Israel because I had the opportunity to come together with my friends and study for the exams together. So I'm glad I didn't went back home to Panama. I think it could have changed my study experience for worse.
Studying on Zoom is widely known to be more difficult for students across the board.
Studying abroad during Corona, I have to admit it was challenging. It feels different because you don't go to class and you have lectures face to face. But the teaching method of IDC, it was really, really good. And so we managed to take the exams in the right way, and I managed to study in the same way with my friends.
But even more so, students like Niv and Hana decide to stay in Israel.
Israel, it's Israel. It feels like home, and it's the safest place.
Let's hear about how one international university program in Israel is successfully overcoming those obstacles. Here to talk to us about a special initiative is the Vice President of External Relations from the Interdisciplinary Center Herzliya's Rafael Recanati International School, Jonathan Davis. Thank you so much for joining me today.
How are you, Lauren?
I'm great. How are you doing?
Terrific.
Good. So, you know, obviously, you've had to make a lot of changes in your program and the way you're welcoming students. So tell me about how you're adapting to the current situation.
Actually, amazingly, it seems like the challenges have turned into opportunities.
Wow.
It used to be that when I when we used to have an information session, for example, we used to maybe reach 60 or 70 people who managed to come to campus. And now all of a sudden, we're reaching 200.
Wow.
And in four different continents all at once. And the parents can join in. As well.
I'm sure the students aren't that happy about that, but I'm sure the parents are very happy.
The parents are delighted.
So what does that look like? How is the program of that actually changing and the structure of how you're welcoming the students?
Well, when you have the opportunity of reaching so many people at once, you have the opportunity of intensely communicating with the individuals. And people in different countries, from different backgrounds, from different characteristics, can ask a lot of questions. And you can actually interact on Zoom and hear people with different accents who look different, who come from different countries, and you get an amazingly international, pluralistic impression when that happens.
So I understand this is not the first time you're dealing with an unusual circumstance, of course. In 2014, the last escalation between Israel and Gaza, you also had to adapt to the situation. Why don't you tell me how things changed back then for you?
Well, basically, we are always intensively in contact with our students. We have counselors, and each of those counselors has 25 phone numbers of different students. So in an emergency, if something happens in Israel, we're in contact with that student within a very short amount of time. A, because we want to make sure that they're okay. And B, because we want to be able to report to their parents also that they're okay. And so from a communicative point of view, when you're under fire, such as in 2014, it's actually maybe even simpler than it is now. Because with Corona the way it is, the rules change every day, and you have to keep your finger on the pulse of all the information that's coming out of the Ministry of Health, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the Ministry of Interior, and God knows how many other ministries.
So speaking of COVID, I mean, as you said, every day you have to change the way you're going about doing what you're doing. So what other steps are you taking other than this virtual open house? How have you adapted the entire school to what's going on?
Well, first of all, we received some good news today that the Ministry of Health is allowing students to come back to campus.
Exciting.
So that's already an exciting thing. I understand from the regulations that 20 students will be able to gather together outside somewhere and do something, which is already a good sign. That's number one. Number two, we brought back to Israel between 700 and 800 students. We brought back and also brought here for the first time over the last year, which meant that we had to overcome all kinds of visa implications and flight problems and other constraints and Ministry of Health constraints. And hundreds of our students had to quarantine for 2 weeks. Something they have not been used to. They weren't taught how to quarantine in high school or in junior high school or elementary school. Nobody knew what the plague was. So basically, they come here and they've got to quarantine. So if they have to quarantine, we need to provide them with tender, loving care.
Absolutely. You know, and hopefully these restrictions will only continue to ease and more students will be able to be in campus in person. Jonathan Davis, thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Speaking of post-secondary institutions in Israel being creative, researchers from Ben-Gurion University have developed a new high-speed robot inspired by the movements of cockroaches and lizards. Yep. The Amphistar robot can swim and run on top of water and even navigate difficult terrain. The wheeled robot has four propellers, which can function as wheels on the ground and fins over water. Two air tanks allow the robot to float and transition smoothly between speeds and surfaces. One of the engineers, Dr. David Zaruk, hopes the Amphistar will be used for agricultural, search and rescue, and excavation applications where both crawling and swimming are required. Big news for all you Apple customers in Israel. You'll now be able to make in-store purchases using your iPhone. Apple has signed an agreement with one of Israel's leading credit card companies to bring Apple Pay to the country by the end of the year. Let's find out more from James Spiro, reporter at CTEC by Kalkalist. Hi, James.
Hi, Lauren. How
Welcome, are you? And thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
So what's going on here? Are we really going to be able to pay with our iPhones?
It looks like Israel is finally catching up with the rest of the world. Israel is introducing Apple Pay. It's big news. We can all walk into any store, any restaurant, pay with our phones, or pay with our watches and save us a lot of trouble.
So how does it actually work? You open the app and you scan a barcode. What are the logistics behind it?
Right, so most devices have what's called an NFC chip. Now, an NFC chip is a near-field communication chip, and they operate with devices that are about 1 or 2 centimeters apart.
Okay.
So that's the device where you can kind of take your phone and tap a register. And what the Apple iPhone, or what any iPhone does, is you tap it and it automatically communicates with the bank or the register and charges you.
So far one credit card company has made a deal with Apple, but there are others on the way. Is that gonna maybe limit where we're able to pay with Apple Pay? What's going on?
Right, so at the moment there's Israel Card, and Israel Card works, I think, on about 4 million cards and 100,000 stores. So
wow.
Already it's gonna open up a lot for Israel. And there are more in the pipeline, but they just need to pass their technical tests first.
And is there like a similar system for Android users, or is Apple Pay the only system of its kind?
So for every Apple, there's an Android.
Of course.
Android had Android Pay, and Google had Google Wallet, and
Okay. Obviously
Google owns Android, so they combined that to turn it into Google Pay. So there's Apple Pay and there's Google Pay. I don't know the plans yet for Israel and Google Pay, but we'll see.
So, you know, one thing that I hear a lot from Apple customers in Israel is that they, you know, wish that there was more of an Apple presence in the country. We don't even have official Apple stores. Is this signifying that we could have more Apple in Israel?
Look, I hope so. You know, it's very frustrating every time a phone or a watch breaks, you have to kind of ship it off somewhere to get it fixed or go to these third-party retail stores. Look, I'll welcome an Apple store as much as the next guy. I really do hope that is the case.
Okay, and when do they say we can officially start tapping our phones and buying things?
So it's from, the larger businesses are from the end of November this month.
Okay.
And the smaller businesses have a bit more time to catch up. They have until about early next year.
Wow, very exciting. James Spiro, thank you so much for coming in today.
Thank you.
All right, let's take a look at the weather forecast. Depending on where you are in the country, you could end up with rain, clouds, or clear skies on Friday with highs of about 73 degrees Fahrenheit or 24 degrees Celsius. Saturday will be a touch warmer, bringing highs of around 77 Fahrenheit or 25 degrees Celsius. And now, just before we go, let's take a look at what's going viral in Israel. Yep, the rain season has obviously started in Israel. As you can see, there was some flooding in Israel's south after our first couple of storms. And this is tubing, so we had to show you a man literally in a tube going down the street in that flood. Crazy stuff. All right, that's it for today's news. Today's exchange rate is 3.38 shekels to the American dollar and 2.58 shekels to the Canadian dollar. For more news from ILTV, please like ILTV on Facebook, follow us on Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube and Roku TV pages. I'm Lauren Izzo. Thanks so much for watching.